there's an old show called The Twilight Zone. So what I thought, my initial reaction when I thought the script is, wow, this is amazing. This is like an episode of The Twilight Zone, modernized, made into a movie. Like, I don't know why someone didn't think of this years ago. And the movie came, and nobody saw it. And then you guys saw it.
It got some footing on, I saw it on cable. I think a lot of people saw it that way.
Yeah,
cable
and sales. DVD.
Yeah. So I definitely got a following. Now, there was a director's film that came out a few years back.
I'm shedding.
A director's came out a few years ago, which kind of explained the film a little more. How was that incorporated in the original script?
That's a really good question. I can tell you, and I'm going to ask you as fans of the movie and as a favor, not just to yourselves, but to me, start a petition. Ask for the Sundance cut. There's a cut of the movie no one has seen. When we first made the movie, which is Rich Kelly's original vision, is in between the theatrical cut and the director's cut. So to give you an example, we screened it at Sundance, and nobody wanted to pick the movie up except for one company. The company did another movie called Memento, done by the new up-and-coming filmmaker Chris Nolan. And there's a really weird movie if anyone here has seen it. And if you haven't, I absolutely recommend Memento. It is crazy, and it's amazing, and it's weird. And they're like, well, you know, we picked up Memento, and we think, you know, we know it. You know, we think we want to put your movie out. In fact, you know, we just want to ask you one thing. You got to cut 10 minutes out of the movie. We don't care what you cut out, but make it 10 minutes shorter. That's the theatrical cut. Then when the movie had done well on, you know, DVD and video, which was beyond our expectations, the company came back and asked him to make a director's cut. You know, could you go back and put some stuff in and we'll give you some money. So they actually shot a few additional, like, not scenes, but footage, you know, like the cabinets opening and the flooding in the office and in the sky.
And I think there were more eyeball shots that were shot at that point too.
Yeah, and then they added the pages of the philosophy of time travel, which I'm glad he did, because I actually asked him for that book when we were filming, and he's like, James, it doesn't exist. I'm like, you really, really need to write this, man, I'm telling you. And then the director's cut, he put it in there. And the great thing about that is, for all you fans, notice that the philosophy of time travel only has odd chapters. Chapter 1. Chapter 3, chapter 5, chapter 7. There are no even chapters in that book. And they are inside when you watch the director's cut. So all of those things were really, really cool and added a lot. But I think that the cut that was in between, without being given some of that extra stuff, but taking back some of the scenes that were originally pulled out from, again, what I call the Sundance cut or the Sundance Film Festival cut. And I like all the cuts, but to me that's always been, you know, I'm absolutely biased because it's also the first cut I saw. But I love that cut. And I think you guys should have a chance to see it. And I know they have access to it. And you know the company, anything to sell another DVD or Blu-ray, you get a cut that you've never seen. That makes it worth it.
What was the process? I mean, by the time you shot it, you already had a number of films under your belt. You did, you know, the independent films you already done, Independence Day. Now, what was the process like for you getting the role?
Well, that was interesting. It's not something I thought I was going to actually get. And my process to Donnie Darko was similar to like Go and a couple of other movies that I did done at the time. You know, sometimes I can get a script and not like it, and I end up shooting it, and I'm working with really great people, and I find things to like, and I can become surprised. And the same thing, sometimes I get a script I've really liked and I've made it and just was miserable doing it and just didn't, you know, at the end I was like, that wasn't good. So these expectations I realized that I had set meant nothing. And I absolutely have no idea until I actually step into it. So that being said, I'm sorry, I stayed directly.
Just give me a role in general.
The audition came to me and they said, okay, we're gonna have you audition for Frank the Bunny. 6 foot tall, blonde. All right, let me think about this. That's 6 feet, definitely not blonde. I forget it. You know what? This script's amazing. I'm gonna steal this role. That's exactly what I thought.
So you're like Tom Cruise in *The Vampire*. You're like totally opposite of the role.
Yeah. Well, at the end, I think for them, which was like there was two things which I don't normally like to toot my own horn, but it's something I'm actually really proud of. They said the reason why I got the part was one. And I'm the only one who got it. Like everyone who did the audition actually didn't get the scene. So the audition scene is when I run over Gretchen as, it's his sister, not Rose. Rose is the mom. Maggie Gyllenhaal's character. I'm her boyfriend through the whole movie. I drop her off in the very beginning. That's my orange Trans Am that you hear honk, see drop off the sister. You know, you hear the honking and the jet engine comes.
And she mentions the name at some point in the film too.
Oh yeah, Honey Frank's on the phone and she comes in and is like, yeah, my brother told the teacher like stuff the thing in her butt and then they're gonna give him a car. You know, so she's talking to me. When there's the little note on the fridge. And for those of you who haven't seen it, I don't think you'll be able to follow this, which is good. But there's notes on the fridge, so there's little things that are left by me as his sister's boyfriend. Yeah. So it's kind of, I'm the old, like, I think everybody went in thinking he was a supernatural character, and I knew he never was. For me, I was like, oh no, I mean, so what happens, because I can read it 100 times to make sense of it, but reading it over and over and picking up those nuances, I realized, like, oh, wow, I'm just his sister's boyfriend, who got in their alternate reality because he stepped out of the jet engine. So things in the future, you know, unfold differently. And he drives drunk and he runs over Gretchen and he gets shot in the eye. He gets shot in the eye at a Halloween party in his Halloween costume that at the very end you saw him drawing. So he's not a supernatural character. So when I went in for the audition, it's just, it literally was, which you'll see, what are you guys doing in the middle of the road, huh? What were you thinking? And he's a kid. And I think everybody, you know, that at least what they said, they came in and they were like, kind of, what were you doing? In the middle of the road. And it was, you know, I mean, it's a hard thing to kind of, you know, I think comprehend at the time. And maybe, you know, it could have just been lucky for me too, but they were like, yeah, you gave the best reading. I mean, you're the only one who got it.
Well, especially at that point in the film,